Hello, my friend. Thank you for joining me today. I have got a super interesting message to share with you. It's about a good king with a very bad habit. And interestingly enough, it's the same habit that some very good people have today. I think you're going to find this illuminating, provocative perhaps, and I know you're going to find it helpful. If you've got a Bible, why don't you grab it? Let's sit down, get into God's Word together, all right? Hi, I'm Bayless Conley. In life, we all face uncertainty, whether it's financial troubles, relationship valleys, a health crisis, or just trying to discover your purpose. One thing is for certain, God sees you, He loves you, and no matter what you're facing, He has the answers. Well, we're on a series, beginning one, about prophets, kings, and queens, and looking at the lessons that we can learn from the people in those categories and their stories, the good and the bad and the ugly and the beautiful and everything that happened with them. And we're going to be looking in 2 Chronicles 17, so you can go ahead and turn there if you have your Bible with you. We're going to start there. We'll go back and forth between 2 Chronicles and 1 and 2 Kings for the most part. And I'd like you to pray with me, if you would. Heavenly Father, we just settle our hearts down right now, and we choose to become still inside and to listen. And we thank you for your supernatural hand that is here at work today, throughout this building, throughout this campus, and in the hearts and lives of every person that's watching and listening. Amen. All right. Where we're going to jump in is an interesting time in Israel's history. The nation has actually been divided. 10 tribes took off, you know, they severed themselves from the tribes of Benjamin and Judah, established a new capital in the north in Samaria. They're known as Israel. And for a 200-year period, they had 19 kings in the north, and not a single one of those kings ever loved God or served God. To a man, every one of them was wicked. In the south, there's another kingdom made up of the two tribes, Benjamin and Judah, with a capital in Jerusalem. They also had 19 kings over a little bit more protracted time, because in the north, eventually the Assyrians conquered them and they were carried away captive into Assyria. The nation of Judah lasted somewhat longer, but eventually they were taken into Babylonian captivity. But of the 19 kings in the southern kingdom, 8 of them served God. 8 of them loved God. And at this time, the king in the north was infamous. You will have heard his name. It was Ahab. He was married to a woman named Jezebel, and they were abominably wicked. They were both murderers. They were both idolaters. They were both deceitful. They called evil good and good evil. They hated God. In the south, their counterpart at this time was a man named Jehoshaphat. He is the king in Judah, in the south, reigning in Jerusalem. And just a bit of an introduction to what kind of a king he was, 2 Chronicles 17, verse 3. Now the Lord was with Jehoshaphat because he walked in the former ways of his father David. He did not seek the Baals, but sought the God of his father and walked in his commandments and not according to the acts of Israel. Therefore the Lord established the kingdom in his hand, and all Judah gave presents to Jehoshaphat, and he had riches and honor and abundance, and his heart took delight in the ways of the Lord. Moreover, he removed the high places and wooden images from Judah. Now, if we were to read on, we would find out that Jehoshaphat loved the word of God. He also loved justice. He was a good king with a bad habit. And we're going to be talking about that. 2 Chronicles 18 and verse 1. Jehoshaphat had riches and honor and abundance, and by marriage, he allied himself with Ahab. He took Ahab and Jezebel's daughter, Alethea, and made her the wife of his son, Joram. And listen, she was worse than her mother was, if you can imagine that. Eventually, Alethea is going to murder all of Jehoshaphat's grandchildren. She's going to plunge the nation of Judah into a long season of oppression, tyranny, and idolatry. And there's no record that Jehoshaphat prayed about this alliance in any way whatsoever. He had the propensity to make ungodly alliances and then ask God about it after he'd already committed himself. And it's something he did pretty much throughout his lifetime. He would connect himself and join himself and pledge himself to the wrong people and then not ask God about it until things were basically too late. You know, I have a friend that a number of times he has hired key people to be in very prominent positions in his church. And he has done it numerous times without waiting on God or asking the counsel of trusted friends first. And invariably, these guys that he brings into these key roles, they have split the church and caused untold grief again and again. And not too long ago, he confided in me and a couple of friends, and he said, "I have no discernment when it comes to people." Was it the same thing with Jehoshaphat? Was it just that he had no discernment? Or was it out of a desire to gain more wealth and more territory? Did he think that he was going to change these people after he had allied himself with them? That somehow he was going to influence them and change them? Or maybe he just wanted to be liked and thought of as being gracious. We don't know, but it was a habit, as I said, that persisted for most of his life. We read on 2 Chronicles 18, verse 2. After some years, he went down to visit Ahab in Samaria, and Ahab killed sheep and oxen in abundance for him and the people who were with him, and persuaded him to go up with him to Ramoth Gilead. So Ahab, king of Israel, said to Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, "Will you go with me against Ramoth Gilead?" And he answered, "I am as you are, and my people as your people. We will be with you in the war." Wait a minute, Jehoshaphat, "I am as you are?" No, you're not. Ahab hates God, you love God. Ahab is wicked, you're righteous. Ahab is deceitful, you're honest, and you love justice. Ahab is an idolater, and you serve the one true God. I am as you are. What are you saying? I'm going to go with you in the war. And then look, the very next verse, verse 4. Also, Jehoshaphat said to the king of Israel, "Please inquire for the word of the Lord today." Shouldn't you have done that first? Shouldn't you have asked God about it before you pledged yourself and committed yourself? I mean, you've made the commitment, you're all in, and now you're going to see what God has to say about it. You connect yourself to an ungodly man, and then you pray. Now, so Ahab calls 400 false prophets in. These are the prophets that would prophesy for him and Jezebel. And we've got Ahab sitting on his throne, and Jehoshaphat sitting on his throne in the threshing floor, and these 400 guys are carrying on. They're saying to a man, they said, "Go up to Ramoth Gilead. The Lord has delivered the Syrians into your hand. You know, go." The Lord says, "Go." And Jehoshaphat is uneasy. He says, "Isn't there any more prophets?" And Ahab says, "Well, there's one guy, Micaiah, but I hate him because he never prophesies good concerning me." Jehoshaphat says, "You shouldn't say that. Bring him." And the messenger that goes to get Micaiah says, "Listen, all 400 guys, this is what they've said. Make sure you say the same thing." And he must have done it in a real sarcastic voice, because he starts out, says, "Go, you know, the Lord's going to deliver the Syrians." And Ahab says, "Come on, you know, just tell me the truth. And he says, all right, you're going to die. You won't be coming back from this battle. And I saw Israel scattered like sheep. It's going to be a disaster. And they went anyway. And everything Micaiah said came to pass. And Jehoshaphat barely escapes with his life. He cries out to God while he's being chased by these charioteers, and God intervenes, saves him. But a bunch of his men were killed. And he literally barely escapes with his life. It was an absolute disaster. And then we come to 2 Chronicles 19 and verse 1. It says, then Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, returned safely to his house in Jerusalem. And Jehu, the son of Hanani, the seer, went out to meet him and said to King Jehoshaphat, should you help the wicked and love those who hate the Lord? Therefore, the wrath of the Lord is upon you. Nevertheless, good things are found in you in that you've removed the wooden images from the land and have prepared your heart to seek God. Should you help the wicked and love those that hate the Lord? Jezebel and Ahab weren't just neutral. They hated God. They weren't just deceived. They hated God. They hated the Word of God. They hated the things of God. They hated the people of God. They hated the prophets of God. They had set themselves to be completely opposed to God. They were incorrigibly wicked. And the prophet says, should you help those that are literally God's enemies, that hate God? Now, Jehoshaphat, you know, unfortunately, you know, when you become an ally of someone that hates God, some of what's on them is going to get off on you. And so he said, hey, you know, wrath of God is against you because God's wrath is already over these guys. And if you're making this kind of alliance, to a degree, you're going to share in some of that. But there's good things in you, Jehoshaphat. So he, to his credit, you know, he goes on serving God and doing good to Judah. And he's a good king. We fast forward just a few years, and now Jehoram, one of Ahab's sons, has become king in the north. It was actually a co-regency there for a period of time. But Jehoram, Ahab's son, is there, and he's wicked just like his father and mother. He's an idolater like they were. And we pick it up this time, 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 6. So King Jehoram went out of Samaria at that time and mustered all Israel. Then he went and sent to Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, saying, the king of Moab has rebelled against me. Will you go with me to fight against Moab? And he said, I will go up. I am as you are. My people is your people. My horses as your horses. Jehoshaphat, I am as you are. No, you're not. This guy's like his parents. He's wicked. You know, he doesn't serve God. He doesn't love God. You're not like him. But Jehoshaphat just jumps right in. Yeah, I'm going. You know, I'm pledging to be there. So he makes this alliance. And the king of Edom also joins them. So there's these three kings. King of Israel in the north, king of Judah in the south, Jehoshaphat, and the king of Edom. And the next thing we read, this is Jehoshaphat asking, then he said, which way shall we go up? And he, that is Jehoram, the king of Israel, answered, by way of the wilderness of Edom. So the king of Israel went with the king of Judah and the king of Edom, and they marched on that roundabout route 7 days. And there was no water for the army, nor for the animals that followed them. And the king of Israel said, alas, for the Lord called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. Isn't that typical? All right, you went up. God didn't send you. You just went. You're the one that chose the roundabout route. There was a route where there was water. But he says, okay, this is the way we're going to go. They go the roundabout route. There's no water 7 days. And then he blames it on God. He says, well, the Lord has delivered us. Isn't that just like people? They make choices in their life that have consequences, and then they blame it on God. I don't know why the Lord's letting this happen. Oh, it's just because you're stupid. And that's what's happening here. Well, the Lord did. No, the Lord didn't do that. This is your own doing. This is your own choices. And then we come to verse 11. But Jehoshaphat said, is there no prophet of the Lord here that we may inquire of the Lord by him? So one of the servants of the king of Israel answered and said, well, Elisha, the son of Shaphat, is here, who poured water on the hands of Elijah. Isn't this a little late, Jehoshaphat? Shouldn't you have inquired the word of the Lord before you ever joined yourself to this wicked guy? Shouldn't you have asked God about it before you ever made the commitment and the alliance? Shouldn't you have asked God about things before you got in trouble and now you're about to die? All the animals are about to die and you're about to lose your entire army. Now you're going to pray, last ditch effort. Well, thank God that's better than not praying at all. But Jehoshaphat, you should have done this first. Jehoshaphat, verse 12, Jehoshaphat said, the word of the Lord is with him. So the king of Israel, Jehoshaphat, and the king of Edom went down to him. Then Elisha said to the king of Israel, what have I to do with you? Go to the prophets of your father and the prophets of your mother. But the king of Israel said to him, no, for the Lord has called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. He's still blaming it on God. He's still completely fatalistic. When we come to verse 14, Elisha said, as the Lord of hosts lives, before whom I stand, surely, were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not look at you nor see you. We're going to come back to that. But from this point, Elisha calls for a musician. The musician begins to play. The hand of the Lord comes on Elisha and he prophesies. And he tells them what to do. And it was crazy. He said, dig ditches. Now, I know there's no rain, there's no water. God says, dig ditches and he's going to bring water supernaturally. Absolutely ridiculous. Friend, sometimes you have to do the ridiculous if you're going to experience the miraculous. You need to obey God whether it makes sense or whether it doesn't. And so they did it. They dug ditches out there and God supernaturally brought water. All of the animals are, you know, their thirst is quenched. All of the soldiers are refreshed and renewed. And in the morning, as the sun's coming up and that red sky is there, the king of Moab and his army are looking across the battlefield and they see that the red, you know, sun of the morning shining on the water and they just said, it's blood. Those three kings, their armies have all turned on each other. They've killed one another. Let's go get the spoil. So he brings his army into the jaws of an absolute trap and the Moabites are slaughtered. Now, the thing is though, Jehoshaphat's alliance with an evil man almost cost him his life and almost cost him the lives of all of his men. And if he had lost the army, it would have endangered the entire nation. So this choice he's making, not just affecting him, would have affected all the men in the army, all of their wives, who now no longer have husbands. Now there's no one to protect their cities, you know, and their holdings. And it affects everyone. My friend, all of our choices have consequences. No one lives to himself and no one dies to himself. You try and do something in a corner, it never just affects you. There's always a rippling effect. It always affects other people. Thank God for his mercy. But there's something here that I feel so strongly that I need to talk to you about. And it's back to verse 14. Elisha said, surely were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I would not look at you nor see you. And what we need to consider is the influence of one godly person. The influence that one godly person can have. Jehoshaphat was flawed, certainly, but he did love the Lord. These other two kings and their armies were delivered because Jehoshaphat was there. They became the recipients of God's favor because of the presence of a godly man. Do not underestimate the influence and impact that one godly man or one godly woman can have. Acts chapter 16, Paul and Silas are in prison in the city of Philippi. And at midnight, as they're chained in the innermost prison, they began to pray and worship. They're singing praises, and suddenly there was a great earthquake, and the scripture says, all of the prison doors were open and everyone's chains fell off. It didn't just impact Paul. It didn't just impact Paul and Silas. Everyone in the prison, their doors flew open. Everyone in the prison, their chains were loosed. The influence of one godly man. Acts 27, they're in a great storm, 276 people on a ship. All hope that they would be saved was given up. They all knew they're going to die. But an angel appeared to Paul in the night and said, "Paul, be of good courage. God has granted you all those who sail with you." They ought to be mighty glad that Paul was on that boat. 276 people saved from certain death because one godly man was in their midst. Oh my. You know, there was a street preacher in the 70s that I really admired because of the simplicity of his message. He just talked about Jesus. But because of his courage, he went into some of the most dangerous places in the world. You know, he traveled internationally and went to some rough spots here in our own country. And just would proclaim the message of God's love and had amazing results. And there was a particular Hollywood actor who was fairly well known, got saved. This was late 70s. And that actor sort of joined himself at the hip with his street preacher. And they could be seen together all over. And occasionally they would interview this actor. And I remember watching one interview. And the guy said, "Look, aren't you afraid for your life?" He said, "You know, when I got saved, God told me to join myself to this man to support him. And whenever I'm at his side, it doesn't matter where I am, I feel like I'm in the safest place that I could be on planet Earth." Never forgot that. He understood something of this principle. Think about Joseph. He sold on the auction block in Egypt. A man named Potiphar buys him, brings him into his home. Genesis 39:5 says, "So it was from the time that he made him overseer of his house and all that he had, that the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. And the blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in the house and in the field." Because of Joseph, his business was blessed because Joseph was there. His household was blessed because Joseph was there. His cattle and his flocks were blessed because Joseph was there. His servants were blessed because Joseph was there. For the sake of Joseph, the influence of one godly man, it brought the blessing of God on the house. What was on Joseph got off on Potiphar and got off on his whole household. You know, I believe that the places I have worked as a Christian have been blessed because I've been there. Now, first, because I've always endeavored to have a good work ethic. I show up early and I'm the last one to leave. First one to get there, last one to leave. And I always kept a good attitude toward my employers. But beyond that, I believe because of the one I love and the one I serve, that the blessing of God was upon them. You know, I remember I applied for a job as a cook in a restaurant many years ago, and the guy was kind of reticent, and I said, "Listen, if you hire me, I will be the best employee you've ever had." And he laughed in my face. I said, "No, I will be." He said, "Look, all right, I'll give you a try." He says, "I'm reluctant, but I'll give you a try." And so I worked there for quite a while. And eventually, I put in my notice I was going to move back to California. And the guy that hired me, the manager of the restaurant, said, "Bayless, can I talk to you?" Calls me in his office. He said, "You know, when you stood in my office, you know, all those many months back, and you said you'd be the best employee," he says, "I thought you were an idiot." He said, "I've been in the restaurant business a long time. I've managed a lot of restaurants, significant restaurants." He said, "You've been the best employee that I've ever had." And he went on to say he was not a Christian. This guy was not a believer. And in essence, he said, "I feel like this place has been blessed because you've been here." Friend, that's because what's on our life can get off on the life of others. Amen. You know, there are certain things on my life that I recognize. One of them, I've got this grace on me that I can sleep. And my heart goes out to people that don't sleep well. I'm sure there are people here listening to me out on the plaza, in here, just listening. You don't sleep well. I've had two friends. One was an acquaintance, the other a close friend. Neither one of them slept more than 2 or 3 hours a night. The acquaintance only made it to his early 30s. His health broke down because he couldn't sleep, just his mind. He died at like age 33. My other friend, he actually pastored a church. Same thing. Sleep 2 hours, maybe three. He made it to, I think, age 50, maybe it was 51. Died because his health broke down. God didn't make any of us to burn the candle at both ends. The only candle you should burn at both ends is the candle of kindness. But these guys, they just couldn't sleep. Well, I've got this thing, I sleep, and everyone in my home sleeps well. There's this sort of canopy of blessing over the Conley house. And I've got another friend, and he doesn't sleep well. He's not one of these 2 or 3 hour guys, but if he gets 5 hours, that's a great night's sleep for him. Generally, he doesn't quite get that much, and he wakes up and his brain is just going and he can't get back to sleep. And I knew, we talked about it and stuff before, and he stayed with me a few times. I remember the first time he said, I said, you know, you're gonna sleep well in my house. He said, really? I said, oh yeah, just watch and see. He said, there's something over my house. You'll sleep while you're here. I get up in the morning, I go, it's 9 a.m., he's still in bed. I go, how'd you sleep? He said, great. He calls it the Rip Van Winkle anointing. But even Jesus, you know, when he sent out the 12 and then when he sent out the 72 by 2, he told them both, he said, you know, whatever house you come to, greet it. And if they're welcoming, if they welcome you, let your peace rest upon it. Adam Clark, great, you know, Greek scholar, said that that word for peace literally is something that affects spirit, soul, and body. It is tangible. What's on you? Get off on them. What's in your life? Well, get off on them. But if they don't welcome you, your peace will come back to you. It is so true that our associations are important. You need to choose your friends carefully because you will become what they are. And as well as choosing the right kind of companions, having the right kind of associations, because who and what they are always rubs off on us, always affects us. And by the way, just a thought I had, I think parents with young children, you need to be careful who your kids associate with. You need to know where they're spending the night. You need to know about the parents and the families there. This is an important subject. But I would say, you know, in the midst of this, and we're not done with this message yet, I like to concentrate on being the kind of person that others would want to associate with, because the good things in my life and the good things on my life will get off on them. So try and be the kind of person that others want to be around, because you have a good influence, and always try and associate with people that are going to bring good into your life or people that you can help, in Jesus' name.
Are you facing a problem that you need an answer to in your health, in your relationships, in your finances? Or maybe you feel stuck in a situation, lacking a clear direction or purpose. You can find answers for your life. You can have direction and purpose with Answers for Each Day. Our online daily devotional, Pastor Bayless unlocks the truth of God's Word and shows you how to find answers for your life in an easy-to-read format. Each devotional shows how easy it is to have an intimate relationship with God by living a practical, faith-filled life in Christ. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and sign up for this free resource, these answers of biblical wisdom and teaching are sure to inspire you to dive deeper into what God has for your life. You can receive these inspirational devotionals today for free when you sign up at BaylessConley.com. These beautifully written daily devotionals will deepen your biblical understanding, give you practical steps to create more intimacy in your relationships, and improve your spiritual and physical health. God's Word has the answers for your life. When you go online right now to BaylessConley.com and sign up, each devotional will challenge you to live better, improve your attitude, and walk out the practical solutions found in God's Word. The Answers for Each Day devotional will strengthen your faith and reignite your passion to pursue God's answers for your life. It's absolutely free. Go online right now, BaylessConley.com, to sign up. That's BaylessConley.com.
We're uploading new content every week to help you find answers for your life. So don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. In the comments, let us know how this teaching encouraged you. We'd love to hear from you. Our prayer is that God's richest and best be yours always.